Today we're going to go over a little bit more about the internet, the protocols it works on, and how it operates. Let's go over a little bit about how data it goes back and forth on the internet. I've illustrated it in very simplistic terms before as a straight line basically between a user's computer, the browser of course that they use, an internet service provider, a company that actually allows you access to the internet, and then you go through the internet and you arrive at a web server. Now, it's a bit more complex than that. I want to illustrate a little bit of how it can go. The overall point is that there are a large number of paths that can be taken through physical or wireless connections between all the computers that comprise the internet, the ones that are accessing the internet, the ones that actually allow you access, and the actual web servers where the files for websites are stored. As an illustration, the internet service provider itself, being a company, might have many, many, many actual physical computers that it uses to route traffic. And when you issue a request for a specific website, the internet service provider might use one of hundreds of individual computers to route that request on. In addition, the website itself might actually maintain duplicates on its web servers. Why? Say it's a very heavily trafficked site, a lot of people visit it. One physical machine may not be able to handle all the traffic of the number of users all at once that are trying to access the website. So they clone the site through one or two or 100 or 1,000 servers. And then when a request comes in, there's special computers and programs, an actual PC and then a program, that keep track of the requests, routing them, receiving the information back as a response, and then sending it back to the originating browser. So again, this is still a rather simplistic diagram. If you were going to diagram out the internet, well, one, you wouldn't do it because you wouldn't have enough time. You'd have to live several lifetimes. And two, you would be spaghetti. But the basic concept is this. Any one individual request or response might route through many different computers on its journey. And you need to know that. Why do we do that? Well, part of it, as we've seen, is there might be multiple machines just to handle the traffic load. But the other part of it is that the failure of any one of these computers involved in this entire chain will not bring down the whole chain. The system will still work. So the fact that there's redundancy in some of the physical machines used in this system is by design, so that there's reliability of the communication back and forth between all the computers that make up the internet. Another thing worth going over is how we transfer data between computers on the internet. Now, how can be a very broad subject. What I mean specifically is this. If you have a file that's, say, on a personal computer, let's say it's your resume, and you want to send the resume as an electronic file, .doc, very likely, and let's say you call it resume.doc because you're really brilliant and creative with your file names. You have to somehow get the electronic file that's on your computer over to the web server for whatever, say, job board that you want the resume to go to, and it gets stored on there. Your resume.doc file is now stored on there. Well, why? Well, probably because you want recruiters to be able to log into that website and see that resume. So here's the point. Let's say it's a rather large resume. Let's say you include pictures and videos going all the way back to eighth grade, and it's just a massive giant file. If you attempt to send it all at once, and somewhere along here, the process breaks and has to start over again, you can see that you've got the potential with the larger and larger files for very inefficient operation. If at any point along the way, one of the computers messes up and the operation has to restart, the whole operation, sending this entire file, might take, oh, I don't know, 3 minutes, just for illustrative purposes. So, what do you do? Well, what you do is you take the file and you break it up into tiny little pieces. You literally take the electronic data contained in that file, the letters and numbers and characters and such, and you break it into small sections. And you order each section. And then you send them, maybe one at a time, or maybe all at once, but they're separate individual transactions, separate individual send, verify it was received, and let the person know that it was received. That's basically how that process works. So why would you do this? Well, first of all, if any one part of it fails and has to be redone, you're only redoing a tiny, tiny part of the overall file in terms of sending it. The other part of it is that the overall product could be gotten a lot more quickly. You could transfer the entire large file much more quickly if you use several different computers along the way to handle small sections of it, because you can send them all at once. So let's say instead of 3 minutes, let's say sending one of these takes about 20 seconds, but they all get sent at once. The entire file gets sent in 20 seconds, a great savings of time. Now, what happens when you send this is, because you've included the data of what order these sections go into, when all of them eventually arrive at the destination computer, they can be put in order and the file gets reconstructed, if you will, and then stored on that server or whatever else is going to happen. Now, again, this is illustrative only. There's a lot more technology behind this. These little individual pieces that are sent are often called packets. It's a packet of information. When you add up all the packets, it is the entire whole file. And you can learn a lot more about this as you become a software developer. But for now, just understand that a large file can be split up into small pieces, sent one at a time or all at once via multiple channels, and reconstructed at the destination computer. And again, that is for efficiency's sake and time-saving's sake. And one final note. We talked about protocols. This itself, the operation of breaking apart a file and then sending it and reconstructing it at the destination, obviously, the way to do that needs to be agreed upon. And there are, in fact, protocols for that. One of them is called file transfer protocol. FTP. And you'll hear about this and use it a lot as a software developer. But the point, again, overall is that the internet is governed by protocols. It's governed by agreements on how to transfer different types of data. And here's one. If you have a large file, that itself is a type of data, and you want to send it and not have it take forever and be error prone, well, break it apart. And the instructions and guidelines on how to break it apart and then reconstruct it are part of this protocol, the file transfer protocol. Now let's cover the concept of a peer in computer networks. The English word peer simply means someone who's your equal. In computers, it means a computer that is your equal. Let me explain. And the diagram I put up here is something we've seen before, a client-server relationship. Client computers access a server computer, which is a central source of data or services or both. And the clients are totally dependent upon the server for being a central repository or storage point for the data that's needed. Now, this is valuable for a few different reasons. You can actually make the server very, very powerful as a computer, spend a lot of money on this one computer, and then have all the other computers be significantly less powerful because they don't need the massive storage and processing capability that this one computer does, the server. And there are other advantages as well. But it does do one thing. It provides a bottleneck, if you will. It provides one regulating computer that all of these client computers have to interact with in order to get services and data or deliver services and data. Now, if you take a look at this, these computers here, well, they're all clients. They're all equal. Where there's a client-server relationship, there's a hierarchy. The clients are subservient to or dependent upon the server computer. But what if we were to connect these computers? You connect the peers. What if you use a computer program that can find other computers via the internet and just access them directly? They can establish a connection, just like you'd establish a connection to the server. This is called a peer-to-peer relationship. It's abbreviated P2P, peer-to-peer relationship. And it's got a lot of advantages. Here's the simplest version of how this would work in terms of just transferring data back and forth. Before, with a client-server relationship, we had a situation where if there was a file that was needed, it was stored on the server. If that client needed it, it issued a request for the file, and the file was transferred. And we've covered a few basics about how that works. Now, what if there's a file that computer one here needs, and computer two and computer three both have it. Computer one could issue a request to computer two for the first half of the file. And it could issue a request to computer three for the second half of the file. Once both parts one and two are on that computer, they can be combined and you have the entire file. You just cut the transfer time for that data in half. Now, what if we multiplied these computers that had parts of the file by 1,000? The original computer could issue a request for 1/1,000th of the data to every single one of these computers, one after the other in order. I want part 1,000, I want part 999, part 998 all the way down. And at the end of the day, when all of these are assembled on this computer, you stack them all up, put them together, you recombine them, and you have the original file. Now, there are peer-to-peer networks all over the world, and they're used generally for transferring large files back and forth. Some of them are used for quite honest purposes. One thing to know as a software developer, if you don't already know this, is that there are peer-to-peer networks around the world that are used to transfer illegally obtained files, computer software, games, songs, movies, that sort of thing. What you do in your own personal ethics is up to you. As a professional, I highly advise staying well away from anything involving illegally transferring copyrighted material. It'll just keep you safe in life, plus it's the honorable thing to do. However, it is a thing to know about peer-to-peer, and it's something that everyone in the industry knows, is that they are associated with some illicit activity. One last thing to say about the internet. As of today, 2017, when I'm recording these videos, no one owns it. It's a giant network of computers all around the world. They all have common protocols about how to transfer data. And for the most part, all around the world, these computers are free to transfer information back and forth. That isn't true in every place in the world. For example, some very strongly run regimes in the world, in China and North Korea, have restricted access to certain parts of the internet from within their country. Not an easy thing to do, but they do it. You should know that for the most part, no one governing country or commercial or nonprofit organization runs or controls the entire internet. It's a consortium, large collection of organizations all around the world. That's the way it is right now.